helps up legacy events.
Every time you talk about 3D printing with people in entertainment, everyone just seems to think it's movies like Paranorman, Aardman's The Pirates, things like that, on more stop motion level of things. But a little video that we put together here will show you how we're using 3D printing and how we've been using 3D printing. Game on how we've thrown 3D printing in entertainment besides just doing static characters and figures. Even though that's our backbone, we try to apply it into everything we do. So a little bit of history about Legacy. We're the original Stan Winston studio. And after Stan passed, we reinvented ourselves to use this technology more in place with traditional sculpting as well, and just to merge all of the areas together to come up with the best possible product, character, anything for a feature. So it dates back into 1998 when we're working on some small movies, something called Small Soldiers, and a lot of people don't realize just in the opening of Small Soldiers, it featured 3D printing. And this is a little tidbit from the open that SLA technology was actually So a lot of people don't even realize the technology's been around now that patents are expiring and getting more into the consumer world, into the hobbyist world, that this is what we've been involved in for some years now. So going from 1988 to 1998 up until more present times, in 2007 we started utilizing some more SLA on more projects to take full responsibility of the technology, such as what you're seeing right here is the first ever Iron Man parts being run in SLA. This is from the Mark III, and that's Eddie Yang, and next slide is Dave Merritt, leader of our model shop, actually looking at these first prototypes that came back in-house and really started revolutionizing how we were going to build our suits and things like that. And then here's a clay-up of one of the first Iron Man helmets being made back in 2007.
And that was really one of the first times that, I mean, as far as we know in the entertainment industry, that they had ever used a you know, taking a scan, never having a practical thing in front of you, building something entirely in 3D, and then just crossing your fingers and doing full size parts and hoping that the person is going to fit in them, the joints are going to line up.
The scale is correct.
Well, okay, that didn't work every time. But the scale features, everything had to kind of coalesce and make this this suit. It was the first time that we were aware of that anybody was doing it for the entertainment industry on that scale. So you have to realize how many fingers were crossed while this was
exactly
happening.
Since you're on the scale, sorry.
Yeah.
Did you define a best practice for figuring out the right scale of the computer before coming out?
Well, it's a culmination of years of practical effects. I didn't always do digital effects. I did makeup effects for 17 years before I ever did any digital. So what we would do in the practical world is we'd do a life cast on somebody and then shave that life cast down and knowing, you know, okay, we're gonna take some off at the wrist, some off at the under the arms and the crotch, and you just kind of knew what you needed to do. And knowing that you probably are going to have two or three people in the suit, you took a best guess to scale on an actor, and then took those dimensions down again, best guess. But that's all you were going to be able to do in the practical world anyway. If you were sculpting the suit from scratch, you would say, okay, I'm doing it over this body form, and materials given, you know, their limitations, you could end up with the same, you know, problems that you have printing something at full scale, never having touched a physical object. So, you know, knowing what we know about how to build a suit in the practical world, our best guesses were probably better than most people's best guesses. I mean, if you were gonna just build one, you know, from scratch on your own, you would run into all the problems that we've solved over the past, you know, 30 years of doing, you know, practical suits. So
the big trick was translating the technology to the practical, I would say. Just
making
sure that your scale was okay. Will this body flex a little bit? Are we going to be able to tighten this?
Yeah, there's a lot of technologies that had to be shoehorned into submission, you know, because they don't always do what you want them to do, and the limitations of the machines or the amount of the polygons that you're dealing with in any given project, or the scale of the piece having to be, can I break it up into four pieces and print the four pieces and put them back together, or does this thing need to be one piece? You know, all these things had to be taken into consideration anyway when you're doing you know, maquettes or helmets or suits or makeup for that matter. That no makeup is just sculpted and then molded and put on somebody. It has to be broken down into multi-piece makeups to be applied piece by piece. So all these things kind of, I won't say seamlessly happened, but over a period of time, you start to realize what things work and what things don't. So
the other kind of things that we had going on too from a business perspective is, around this time, we were hit with a recession. So things were coming to us a lot differently as far as people wanted to do stuff cheaper. People still wanted to change things at the 24th hour on us. So we're relying on this technology and really getting in bed with this technology to figure out how to make it work for us within the limitations of just what was going on from a business perspective. You know, a simple mistake easily could put us over budget.
Yep.
So, and then as far as what Scott was getting to too is, and everyone just assumes the Iron Man suit's 3D printed. Yeah, it is 3D printed, but a lot of times we 3D print masters. And so our master patterns get then cast off into different materials. So we've come up with secret sauce and how we design over the actor's skin, and we shrink things, we stretch things that we know will be compensated later down the line in the casting process for a specific material.
And so I think we see that in exactly. a few more slides. It's, you know, that thing is directly
exactly
reflected.
So in 2008, we were trying to figure out how we were going to bring this technology in-house, because at this point we were sending out a house, and that's great, but we have clients' files that need to be protected. We want to get more knowledge by having our hands on these machines, so I decided to bring in an Eden 260V. At the time it was an object machine, which is now Stratasys, and immediately Scott and I started playing with it and coming up with some techniques. But I think one of the highlight projects that we did on that in-house machine right off the bat was a project that Ian was in charge of.
It's one of the first things I did there, actually.
Yep, was reworking the original Iron Man gloves. The original Iron Man gloves on the first suit were an afterthought. So they were traditional.
They were hand sculpted.
Yeah, they were garbage. I mean, they were not.
No offense, Richie.
They were not to the caliber of the rest of the suit. So we had the opportunity when we brought this machine in, and Ian was designing with another engineer, Brian Hahn, and they were asking me if some things were possible with making connectivity of finger digits and things like that. And I said, we have the technology, let's do it. And after about a week of working files.
Yeah, it was kind of funny because he came from more of a very technical, you know, the scientific side of things or how things are going to be done. And I was coming from more of the art side going, it looks like it's going to work. So we kind of realized that the science was really more of an art than a science as we were going. And realizing how the knuckles were going to bend to never expose anything underneath, realizing how you're going to run wires through this thing. You're never going to be able to mold it because the tiniest of little filament was going to be running through it.
Yeah, you needed a tool steel piece of wire, like a, you know.
20 thou.
Yeah, mm-hmm. A 20 thou piece of wire running through the thing. On a practical piece, you can't drill a curved hole. I mean, with any success. I mean, you can't go, I'm going to drill right down three segments of a finger and have it be perfect, and then go down the other side and do the same thing. And knowing, and you can't lay those kind of things into a mold with any, you know, any repetitive thing is going to, you're going to have problems with it.
And it's such a thin piece that even trying to drill into it would just
and then you saw how many pieces there were. You had to cast that many pieces and they had to be perfect, so.
It would never happen. So what I said was, well, you know, we can go right off the printer, right onto Robert's hands and whoever needs to wear these gloves. And everyone thought we were pretty much crazy.
Yeah, the first test we did, I remember, really didn't work. We actually sent those out, if I remember right, the first tests,
yeah.
Right? And the fingers, when we tried to plate them, they just melted. And we thought, well, it was a fun idea, but it's not going to work until Jason was able to print out the right size.
So, yeah, we started using a different material in-house and realized that, okay, so I'm going to print the left and the right hand in all digits. We're going to basically metal etch and prime them. And then from there, we're going to nickel plate them and then see how this holds up and works. And to this day, we still make our gloves like that.
Someone breaks one, we grow one out and plate it.
I was printing out left and right gloves in 13 hours. So they would literally call me from set, get another three sets going and things like that. So in Iron Man 2, a lot of what you see, especially when they're in the house fight party scene, when Robert falls back on his hands, those are actually 3D printed gloves. So it's pretty nice because now we are actually getting right off the printer, right onto someone, it's our version of direct manufacturing. We're able to just eliminate some processes and allow our mold shop and our model shop to focus on other areas of build, stuff that's more back to what their traditional skill set is, rather than being sanders. So it's a really nice way of working. So that's around 2008, and you know, we've got a lot of machines since then, which I'll go with through after this, but what was announced about a week ago tomorrow was the Connex 3, a full color machine, multi-material, and we've been playing with that thing for about 10 months now. So we're able to, right off of a printer, do things like this, which is super, super nice. We have so much more color stuff as well, but movies aren't out yet that we can't show it, but we've been 10 months in the game now on this technology, so my presentations are always about 2 years behind what we're currently working on.
We're still starting Avatar stuff, and it's like, you've seen Avatar, right?
So, I mean, what we're doing these days is just absolutely amazing, making molds, things like that. The opening video where you saw Jennifer Lawrence running around, and everyone always asks, well, what was 3D printed on that? Well, that was the genius Scott Patton coming up with patterns, and then we busting out 3D printed tools to actually run the makeup applications out of a 3D printed tool for her bodysuit. So that's
scales.
Pretty neat stuff that will be
Her makeup was 3D printed, and we've done a considerable amount of stuff that we can't show 3D printed makeups where we're using scans and printing out the pieces that would traditionally be a sculpted piece. As Richie right there sits there and cringes. This is Richie Alonso right here. He's one of our practical sculptors, and he's slowly edging towards the dark side.
Coming over to us.
He's coming here.
And one thing we do there is it's never one or the other. Almost everything you see is going to be touched by either a digital artist, a practical artist, at some point in the process.
Well, and it's the same theory that with film, where the best effect is the one that uses as many techniques as possible to mask what it is. Because if you have a practical effect, like back in the day when puppets were the big thing, if you marched out a puppet today, the audiences are way too sophisticated for that. you know, but we, you know, and we use the same sort of theory when we're making something. It's like, well, we can grow this, or we can practically sculpt this, or we can, you know, whatever, or even, you know, which machine are we going to use? Are we going to mill this? Are we going to, you know, are we going to use the Perfactory? Are we going to use the Connex? Are we going to use, and it's just, it's becoming so such that we no longer go, how are we going to do it? It's which way is the best way to accomplish it, because we have the tools, we know we can do it now.